My objective is to show you how containers are becoming the nucleus of web scale computing and how they are fundamentally influencing this paradigm. So I want to show you a simple app, but walk you through the entire workflow of what I have just shown you. So time for me to switch to my terminal window. So if you see, I have a bunch of JavaScript files. In fact, I'm developing a Node.js application, which looks something like this. And I have borrowed the classic, popular, well-known MVC to-do application from Backbone.js. So this is production-ready code. I can go live. And what I've done is one line of code that might be of interest to most of you is I basically check for the environment. If it is a development environment, I fall back to my local MongoDB instance. So I use localhost. If it is not development, I use a remote MongoDB connection. This ensures two things. One, I am able to separate the environment with minimal disruption, with minimal configuration. Of course, I may read this from a config file, I can discover it, but to keep it simple, I have hardwired the connection string. But in production, I might actually pull this from a service discovery endpoint or from a config file. But the idea is I have a very clear separation between how I deal with the local dev environment and how I deal with the production environment. And the second important aspect is this ensures that my app is extremely stateless, 100% stateless, which means I can very effectively scale the application without worrying about keeping the stateful data in sync, because I am isolating the statefulness from my app to a centralized service like the MongoLab. So that's the only interesting aspect in this app, but let me go ahead run this and show you how this looks. So it might be pretty familiar to most of you. So I'm running this and it is currently listening on port 3000. So let me switch to my browser and show you. So this is localhost port 3000. And what needs to be done? Ship code, right? So that's what I want to do. So this is my dev environment running on localhost, completely powered by Backbone.js, MongoDB, and Node.js. Okay, so now this is perfect. It's working and it's time for me to move this to my staging environment, right? So what do I do? I don't give a setup script or a configuration file or readme.txt. Instead, I go ahead and build my entire source code into a Docker image. And for that, I put some instructions to build my image in what is called as a Docker file. So the Docker file picks up my source code from my local repository or even the file system, and it takes the Ubuntu 14.04 LTS image as the base, copies my entire source code into a directory called SRC, and runs the apt-get update and the routine infrastructure code, basically to ensure that you know we are getting the latest version of Node.js, NPM, and the depending modules. And we are exposing port 3000. And finally, we move into the SRC directory and kick off the node process with app.js as a parameter. Pretty straightforward. But mind you, this is not a shell script. It's an instruction to Docker to build this into an image. So now that I have the Docker file in place, I can use Docker build followed by a tag. And the tag will distinguish my image from other images. So I give a unique name and I pass the current directory as the parameter. So Docker build will quickly create an image from my current source code, which is completely tested and ready to go. So to save time, I have already created that image. So, okay, let me, okay, so what I've done is I have already moved my Docker image to a local VM. So this is my local VM, which is running the Docker environment. So when I do Docker images, you notice that my to-do app is compiled into an image, built as an image, and is living in a centralized repository called Quay.io, which is owned by CoreOS. This could be Docker Hub, this could be your private registry, it doesn't matter, but this needs to be secure, this needs to be accessible. So once I have this image, I'm going to go ahead and push this image to the central registry, right? So when I do a Docker push, I'm basically getting my image to be deployed on multiple other environments. Again, this is going to take a while depending on the bandwidth. Remember, we have to upload about 235 MB of image, so I don't want to take a chance. So I execute this command, and then it takes us to the repository. So this is my Quay.io CoreOS repository, and here I have the to-do app repository, right? So this is perfect. Now we have successfully moved from a dev to staging. The VM was my staging, and I built my Docker image and pushed it to the centralized repository, and now it's available for going live, right, into production. So for production, I'm on EC2. So I have two VMs running. One is prod2do1, prod2do2, and these are running in the very familiar EC2 environment. And now it's time for us to take our to-do application to production, right? So let's switch back to the command line. So here I have Docker running, right? And by the way, I am on EC2. So this is my EC2 instance. So I'm already running Docker version 1.9.1, the latest. And here I come back and do a Docker pull. So when I do a Docker pull, I'm essentially getting my image to my production environment. So Docker pull, Quay.io followed by my username, and this basically downloads the entire image, which will take a few minutes depending on the bandwidth. So to save time, I have already pulled it and it is ready here. So this is our image, which has flown in from our dev environment, right, into the production. And it's time for me to run this. So if you see the docker ps command, which will show you the running containers, I don't have any container. So what I'm going to do is run this command, which I'm going to walk you through in a second. So when I run this command, I pass -d to run the container in detached mode, and I'm exposing port 3000 of our Node.js app as port 80 of the host, and this aligns with the security group that I already created. And most importantly, I'm passing an environment variable to let the image know that this needs to run in production, which means it will now start talking to the MongoLab instance that we have already provisioned. And this centralizes the database, and it is provisioned in Amazon, so it's sitting next to the app, and we are also ready to scale because we don't have any state. So I pass the image name. So this will now run our container. So we see that it's up and running. Port 3000 is exposed on port 80. So let's come back to the browser and refresh. So now if you notice, this is the IP address that EC2 has assigned to my instance, right? Now the magic starts, right? So it's not just one instance. I can go ahead and launch multiple instances. The only thing is, I don't want to deal with 80 because that's already taken, so I'll create one more with 81. And now we are going to create the third container listening on port 82 and one more with 83, right? Now when we do Docker PS, we notice that there are a bunch of containers that are running listening on different ports. So if you come back to the browser and type the appropriate port number, you would see the same. So if you type something as your to-do list and switch between ports, that would still be retained because this data is stored in MongoLab, It's completely out of the context, right? The state context. So that's the beauty of it. And as you notice, it just takes us a few seconds to scale from one to n number of containers, right? So I have also launched another EC2 instance, and here I'm running a dozen VMs, right? If you see from port 80 to port 91. So let me check how many I'm running with the word count command. So now we have 14 containers running in the second EC2 instance. So now imagine we have two VMs, and across these two VMs, we are running about a dozen containers listening on different ports. And this is fantastic scale, and we are very close to realizing the power of web scale. But that's not all. We still need to live with certain challenges, and that's where the other story begins. So let me switch back to my presentation and talk to you about those challenges. So when it comes to containers, you might be wondering, how do I make sure that the port number is not conflicting? How do I dynamically assign a port and still register it with the load balancer and make the container participate? That is the lingering question in your mind. The second question is, how do I load balance all of them and secure all of them? How do I manage centralized logging? How do I know which container is in healthy state, which is not? And how do I apply some of the best practices of infrastructure monitoring to containers? Well, this problem is not solved by one layer of software. So the application, the container orchestration engines like Kubernetes, Docker Swarm, Mesos, Cisco Mantle, and Rancher address certain problems, certain challenges in the new world of containers. Kubernetes handles quite a lot of them. It's one of the most mature, robust container orchestration engine. Docker Swarm is very simple yet very powerful. Mesos along with Marathon delivers a very powerful container management capabilities, and so does Cisco's open source orchestration engine called Mantle. But they have a well-defined boundary. They are primarily orchestrating the containers and handling some of the challenges of automatically bringing them up and maintaining the state across all this, and when I say state, the cluster state, and they track the health. They do a set of functions to ensure that your containers are in sync and they're delivering what they're designed for. But on top of that, we need an application delivery platform, which will help you bring in the proven bulletproof security to microservices and the high level load balancing, you know, that has to work across the VMs, across the containers seamlessly, and manage the entire logical handoff between the VMs and the containers. And of course, bringing in operational insights from the aggregated logs coming from these dozens of containers running on tens of VMs. And even taking it to the next level by consuming these logs and then applying machine learning to predict how they will behave in different conditions. So that's exactly where Apsito ADS, the application delivery service, comes into the play.